may have sounded odd for our talks this semester started, but I think because people then in the talks, they will have a sense of what that means. He is coming to us from the Geography and the Environment, University of Oxford, and the United Kingdom, PhD in Social Anthropology from the University of Cambridge. He is, one thing he's looking at is toxic waste and nuclear risk in Japan, and that obviously is something that is important given the 2011 tsunami and resulting nuclear disaster. In particular, interested in toxic waste and risk perceptions, where those come from culturally. And I think that's one thing I'm trying to get at in this series of talks is, right, very different cultures around the world perceive issues broadly speaking of things like waste, and potentially very different ways. He's the author of several books, including Boundless Worlds and Troubled Natures. He is apparently an expert in the competitive fencing landscape of Ohio and Lake Michigan, but I'm not sure he's going to talk a whole lot about that. Instead, he will be talking about smuggling, burning, burying, shredding, knowing varieties of waste work in East Asia. So thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, I don't have an English accent. So thank you very much to Jim and John and Nick for inviting me to meet you. And for facilitating my stay. I know it's a really busy time for everyone with exams and interview stuff, so I appreciate you coming by. And I hope to leave a good enough period of time for questions that we can work out all the things that I forgot to say during the talk. So given the breadth of my waste research and different sorts of things stretching from toxic pollution to radiation and that kind of thing, I thought I would focus on the kinds of waste work that I've encountered and the kind of people that I've met during my research. I'm an anthropologist, so I talk to people. I generally go out and kind of strike up conversations with just about anybody, try to have interviews, and look at what's going on in a particular place. Usually waste is very controversial, pollution is controversial. On the way over here, I saw a written in chalk in front of one of the buildings that was this slogan, cancer sucks. Well, cancer is also very much involved in sort of the waste controversy that I'm looking at. And so I can relate to what was written there on the ground. So this would be sort of a slow motion road trip through landscapes of toxic waste and radiation and recycling and so on. So last week, Josh probably described to some of you what e-waste is. Electronic waste, it's also known as Wii, waste, electrical and electronic equipment, and it's a priority waste stream for the UN. It can be very toxic for pollutants, and the parts of the world that are doing a lot of that kind of processing, that's begun to worry people. So I'll be looking at that. And e-waste is basically the smartphone in your pocket, the laptop that's in the bottom of your closet that you're no longer using. And they're in a very inert form when they're a product that you're using, probably. When they're being manufactured and when they're being broken down afterwards, when they're being demanufactured, that is when they can become very toxic and there are all sorts of pollutant chemicals inside. It's called urban mining when people decide to get gold and platinum and palladium and that kind of thing these sorts of waste sources rather than digging in the ground and trying to find it for the first time. So urban mining is one rather politely described as something that's become very controversial. So what I'm going to describe to you, first of all, is the fieldwork that I did in a place called Wynn, which is an extremely hostile place to be social scientists. Not allowed to do it at all in many ways. And they process about 20 million tons of e-waste a year, or up to 20 million tons. It's very hard to say because the figure of the trade itself is so murky. But it has a well-deserved reputation for being very enthusiastic about making money from waste and for wanting to pretend And there are about 5,000 family-run scavenging families, so it's largely loosely based on kinship networks. And there's a population of about 50,000 permanent residents in this town, which is more like a city by American standards, and about 100,000 migrant laborers who come through for a few weeks at a time, sometimes longer, and often perform the most dangerous and rude work. So what happens when a load of e-waste arrives in Wayu? It's usually set upon by sledgehammers, crowbars, screwdrivers, and pliers. And scavengers do manufacture these discarded products. And so we're talking about pretty primitive methods. I mean, this is an outdoor workshop. They're just hammering the parts of the television off. And there are open fires to burn the plastic off of wire, for example. And there are sort of hot plates where they might try to get electronic components off the bottom. So all of this means that there's a lot of air pollution, which makes it a very dirty place. And it's effectively a Superfund site. No such thing exists in China. And the main parts of the trade are finding plastic and breaking it down, so chopping it up and being able to melt it and make it into plastic pellets, which you can then sell to factories and so on who use it in production. And the most pollutant form of waste there in processing is the precious metal conversion. So they're trying to get gold and they're trying to get other sorts of small traces of metal, which are nevertheless very valuable. And again, it's done in the most horrific way with acid washes, and then the residue is poured into the river. And the river is literally black, and it was just the most disgusting thing I've ever seen. Thank God it's visibly polluted, so that no one swims in the place or anything like that. And what's interesting about this is that, and I'll be returning to this theme again, is that a lot of this stuff looks very visibly to us like waste. That television looks like something you don't particularly want to use in your house, and I'm sure you all dispose of waste either one way or another in Ohio and elsewhere. But when waste arrives, when so-called waste arrives in a place like Wayu, it's not looked at as waste at all. This is a very precious resource. People make fortunes off this stuff. And discovering some is seen as good fortune rather than some sort of ecological problem. And I'll be talking a little bit more about that, the way it turns to an extent the idea of environmental justice and these populations as victims. It turns that logic on its head a bit, doesn't it? If people think that this isn't actually waste and they're not worried about pollution, they're actually welcoming these exports or facilitating the smuggling trade from abroad. So there's a lot of village specialization. So to take advantage of all these tens of thousands of migrant laborers, they have self-segregated tasks where, for example, this village here, pictured here, is picking out the sorts of wires that they think are going to be most valuable, the form of the metal inside. They want to make sure that everything is sorted like we like, because that makes the product more valuable. So if the plastic is the same kind of plastic and the metal is the same kind of metal, then they, when they process it, they get more money at the end of it. So there's a lot of time sorting through things. And this area of China is extremely scofflaw and fiercely independent. So they have their own dialect, which is called Shaoshang, and it's a difficult eight-tone dialect. They openly flout the one-child policy, which used to be in place until earlier this year. And so we meet families with six children and seven children. It was next to one of our friends' house, there was a family with eight sons who were all working together. So you get a sense that they don't really care very much about Chinese law or international law. And if any of you was wondering, well, what could the ecological impact possibly be of just putting drones and multiply by a little or more, you can see that it, in this scene here, I mean, you've got different sorts of circuit boards and like in haystacks and piles of mobile phones and heaps of computers and that sort of thing. And what happens if it breaks? All this stuff, all these different sorts of substances are going straight into the dirt and into the water table. There was an epidemic in Guiyu about 15 to 20 years ago where people who were drinking water came down with really severely orange teeth. You know, far worse than you've ever seen with there being someone who doesn't brush their teeth with really, really nasty dental corrosion. And so there's a profusion of dental clinics in Guiyu to allow people who made money in the waste trade to be able to buy crowns and dental care and so on to be able to look relatively normal or have their children look like they don't have much teeth. And so there's a big problem now that the water is piped in from 40 kilometers away. And you can imagine, this, it isn't quite like this right now, I'll talk about this later, how the trade has gone through cycles. But you see that all this e-waste ash is being dumped and burned up in the air. It's right next to the river, so they dump all the refuse into the river. And it's a big problem downstream. But it's also a problem right there in the community. A lot of the waste is buried in the ground. And this means that it's just unbelievable environmental devastation. In this one community, but actually China broadly has quite a lot of similar problems. There's a lot of space in China, and a lot of that is used for waste conversion. So here, briefly, I'm showing you an image, again, next to the river, where these are all discarded circuit boards that have gone through this acid processing. And if you look at the amount of it, and eventually they have to burn it to get rid of it, and eventually all that sort of toxic pollution is getting into the dirt, into the water, into the air. And it is said that Guiyu has the highest lead content in the blood of children, and it also has the highest dioxin levels in China. Which is, I think, really saying something, because there's a lot of pollution in China. So that means dioxin is the most lethal man-made substance. It's effectively a byproduct of aging orange and that kind of thing. Not the sort of thing you want in your community. So this brings me to my waste work. I've been talking about some of the waste work that goes on in Guiyu. I suppose I also engage in waste work because I'm going around and trying to figure out what's going on in those places. And what I call furtive field work is the sort of thing that I'm forced to do often. I'm not very welcome in some of these communities. I've often done work in Japan where I have a lot more freedom than in China, but it's the sort of place where it's difficult to get a visa, it's difficult to come in, and it's difficult to get a field without some cagey evidence of the people who are there trying to stop it from being searched. In Guiyu, these are people who are largely benefiting from the trade, so we have local officials who are making money out of the waste trade. We have the factory bosses and so on who have a lot of political connections. There are also corrupt police, and we also have other sort of people who are otherwise invested in the trade. Just imagine that real estate prices are at a certain level. People don't want the real estate to go down. They don't want their business to be threatened. And, they also don't want people coming from the outside and try to take over the business. So they've over the years, developed a highly successful set of strategies to make it difficult for the central government to get in there for other people to get in. So what we've had to do, and I have a fantastic team of people I work with who are you know, really good at Mandarin dialects and who have been working in China for a long time. And so what do you do if you're trying to get into a place like Guiyu where even having white skin and a foreign-looking face means that I'm probably going to be running out of town. Well, we managed to collaborate with people outside of Berlin and find ways to be driven in their cars out of the the license registration in China, which shows what city you're coming from. So you can't come from in a car from another city. You need to be in a car from where you're going to be, and not attract attention. And we generally managed to find locals who were concerned and interested in helping us out. And so we would sometimes come in at night, we would sometimes meet people outside of town. Other times there would be a festival where foreigners were sort of allowed and expected to be there when we came in. And this all meant that while I was being very clear about my research, and we were all being very clear about what our aims were, and we're being as ethical as possible in terms of protecting our foreigners and making sure everything's all right, we were also forced to kind of creep around a little bit more than is usually the case with anthropology and sociology. Now, another thing that I should briefly mention is that there's this expression, playing edge ball, which comes from ping pong. So table tennis is a really popular sport in East Asia, and a lot of people, the Chinese teams, the great national team, for example. And so they have this idea that journalists talk about edge ball. They report just enough so that they manage to get a nick, so they hit the edge of the table, which is an unreturnable shot, perfect shot. But if you're a journalist in China, you are not only worried about your own job and yourself, but you're worried about protecting your informants as well. And the people who are working with you won't get in trouble. And you don't want to have your newspaper, for example, get in trouble. And so we found that we were also playing a form of edge ball while we were there as well. And so here is a picture of where you can see, I wasn't able to take any kind of photo I wanted, but here you can see, for example, that there are a wagon stacked with bags and things. They're just the most astonishing display of different vehicles overloaded with different sorts of vehicles. It's just crazy. So sacks of plastic, or sometimes sacks full of mobile phones, and all of it either put onto a rickshaw or onto some sort of cart that you could pull, or onto a truck. And so we managed to get into some of these workshops. And these are migrant laborers. That's one of my great friends and collaborators, named Anna, who's a China specialist. And that's a migrant laborer there. So this is a workshop that engages in what should probably be called counterfeiting, but it's sometimes called creating foods. So what they're doing is they're taking capacitors, which is something that can be used inside a television, for example, and they're taking the old ones that have been salvaged from somewhere, and they're making them into new or new looking capacitors. So the migrant laborers are working on the ground floor, and then the more sort of former high school students working upstairs, so I'll show you in a second. And it looks all messy and everything, and it was to an extent messy, but this was actually a very carefully organized and highly efficient workshop where they had a series of workstations. This is the boss, we call her Lady Boss, perhaps I don't know. And she was very friendly and so on, which is a little bit unusual, but she was very serious about the work itself and making sure that everybody was doing what they were supposed to do. And so here we have, we're taking components off in sort of pools of lead to get the hot metal off of the capacitors. They clean them, and then they take these sort of mylar covers and put them on, and then they have these new cardboard boxes. So everything is set up to look perfectly new, and then they're testing them just to make sure that they're charging them. Make sure that they work properly. And it's, again, it's, can you call it counterfeiting or can you call it something else? There are people who work in the industry who say that people in China, basically at this price, they're going to expect that it's a capacitor which has come from, it hasn't come from Taiwan, it hasn't come from China, from Japan, that it's been salvaged or scavenged. And means looking again. And it's hard to confirm that. Here's some of the neighbors downstairs cleaning up the things. These are the trays and so on. This guy just finished high school. He's saving up money to move to Shenzhen. He's starting a new job. And so the people on the second floor were more, I think. They looked like they were sort of social contacts of the people who lost their attention. These are burn houses that that allow you to take components off certain boards and so on. And a lot of this trade has moved to the margins in Guilin. And I'll talk about this a bit later, but the scavenging trade is very responsive to the price that you can get on the global market and the regional market. And with these fluctuations in the price, you have fluctuations in how much work is being done, because nothing is done with some profit. Certainly not doing it for eco responsibility or some lofty sense like that. As well, I would say that Guilin's come under a lot closer scrutiny in recent years. So a lot of the most polluting stuff is moved to the mountains. And so some of the people we spoke to were telling us what we would like to go into the mountains. Washed and so on. Now this is, I'm moving now to Japan. There are formal recycling facilities more or less like this in China too. I just haven't gotten access to. So I've got some images here from Japan. Japan takes this kind of recycling very seriously. There was a law passed in the just after the turn of the millennium that stipulated that I don't think this is the case in the States, and please correct me if I'm wrong, but if you buy a computer in Japan, or if you buy a refrigerator in Japan, the manufacturer is required to take it back from you when you finish it. And sometimes you pay a collection fee, or you used to pay a collection fee. Now that price is embedded in the price that you pay at the store when you get it in the first place. So there are air conditioners and washing machines. Refrigerators and so on are broken down in a very high-tech way. I wasn't allowed to take photos of the actual machines, but if you can imagine a huge ringer that is spinning around the studs, and if a huge refrigerator went down the chute, the thing would just disappear in about 3 seconds. It really is a big, very powerful set of machines to break down any kind of appliances that come in there. So they were chopping these sorts of appliances, and so they're chopping metal and chopping plastic and so on. But again, just like in Guilin, the sorting of the waste is very important. So a lot of what is done in a plate, this is a Panasonic plant called PTEC, or it looks like PTEC, P-E-T-E-C. And this is the flagship of the Panasonic consortium. There's also a Mitsubishi consortium. They compete against each other to try to get the highest percentage of recyclables out of these appliances. Partly because they're able to make savings out of that, and partly because this is in Japan as well. And so what they'll do with a refrigerator, for example, is they'll remove different components. So as you might be aware, there are coolants in refrigerators. You might have to take Freon out or something like Freon. And that, if it gets into the atmosphere, it's a CFC gas and it's a controlled substance in that regard. But it's also something that is harmful to employees and it's harmful to communities. So they don't want this stuff coming out for all sorts of reasons. And so they'll dismantle the parts that would cause problems, and they have separate sorts of processing operations for all these different elements. So to give you an idea, for a refrigerator, they would take out the foam that's in the outside of the refrigerator to make sure that it insulates and keeps cool on the inside. Right? But in that foam, there are CFCs as well. So they have machines that can cut out the foam, and they put these in machines that are able to extract the gases. And then, as I described before, the refrigerator is shoot games and so on. So you have chopped up pieces of metal and plastic, and then these are sold on the open market. And what I began to realize in looking at this trade is that there's something called the Basel Convention. I haven't gone into too much detail about this sort of thing because I was pretty sure that Joss McCloskey last week was talking about the Basel Convention. The Basel Convention is a porous and highly problematic agreement. So it's this international treaty which effectively is trying to prevent dumping of hazardous waste from developed countries to developing countries. And there are all sorts of contradictions because you have places like Hong Kong, which are seen as developing countries, or Singapore, and Mexico is seen as a developed country. So it's okay for America to take, and to some extent, maybe Mexico is, but it's problematic, I think, when you take a lot of hazardous waste and just drive it across the border in NAFTA, and it can be processed under the Basel Convention in Mexico in conditions that are strikingly different than anything farmed in the States. So there are these contradictions in the Basel Convention. And what became clear in looking at a place like Patek is that, and facilities like Patek, is that they're not really trying to make waste into a form that's green and safe, and they're not trying to make the planet better and so on. They're just trying to take forms of waste and make them into resources, and resources that they can sell internationally by the Basel Convention. So, you know, it's a very impressive operation, and they do an extremely good job protecting the workers in there, protecting the environment of the community around. They spend a lot of money doing they're very clever contraptions to very quickly, unbelievably quickly, sort through different kinds of plastic and take out the kinds they want, or to sort through different kinds of metal. High speed conveyor belts come by and manage to get the stuff sorted. And as I explained before, the better you sort, the better the price at the end of the higher the purity, and everybody needs that if they're in that business. But what this effectively means is that if they take the square sort of televisions, before we have these very sleek, nice televisions, which are not nearly as thick and bulky. The reason old televisions are so heavy is that there's something called cathode ray tube in there, and it's mostly made of lead and glass. And so a big TV like this back in the old days was seriously heavy. Move those things around and to do so on periods on different occasions. And so that kind of component in the television would be broken down by a place like Patek. And it would be made not into lead and into glass and lead put into some safe sort of place, but it's made into chipped lead and glass, which is no longer seen as a waste. Seen as something which is a manufacturing resource, something that sells at market. So you see how there are all these ways to get around, just in the easiest way, to get around the strictures of the Basel Convention. So let's see. I'm going to quickly go through some images here. So this is, again, some sense of what Japan has been trying to do, which it hasn't necessarily been able to, but coming up with this regional trade between Japan and East Asia and Southeast Asia in different forms of waste, but of course it's not really allowed to do that. It's been trying to find ways to massage those rules. Here is Japan is famous for vending machines. This is a vending machine, which is trying to take a vending machine and crush it. So you see in the front there are some, again, like with Patek, they've taken out the harmful elements from this vending machine and this Coca-Cola vest and Kishu. Here they're crushing it down and they're then able to sell it. And so I was asking the very kind gentleman who showed me around and said, well, so how much of this are you using in your own production of new vending machines? Because it's the same method. I mean, there's some some impurities, but we're talking about the same language, and it's been crushed and melted down. You can separate the forms of metal in there, and in theory, you would be able to use it again, but in Coca-Cola West is completely uninterested in using the metal that it gets from recycling. They're selling someone else, and that people have slightly lower standards in that regard. So, what are some misconceptions about the waste trade, very briefly? I would argue that nation states are very important, regions are important, because these regulations and these laws have an impact on how the waste trade expands, how it develops. But I would say it's very important, particularly with the e-waste trade, to look at the connections between these regulations. China is doing business with so many different parts of the world. It almost doesn't make sense to look at Chinese waste policy or Chinese industry. We're talking about many millions of tons coming from outside of China. And we have a thriving domestic trade as well. It's hard to separate the two. And so I would say you need to problematize this idea of East Asia as a somewhat monolithic region, particularly if you're doing sort of research in the future. And as I said, is this really recycling? I mean, the word recycling has a nice ring to it because we associate recycling with green sorts of people responsibility, and recycling is seen as good. In some of these places, the formal facilities of the kind that I've shown you, it's very easy to pollute if you've got this huge facility and no one can see it from the outside. And so it's not really the case, first of all, that all of this demanufacturing in China, it's not always like what I just showed you in Wynn. There are formal facilities there. But formal facilities all over the world are at least at risk of creating pollution. Some of them, I think, probably do that more than they're willing to say. And as I said, this is not really waste in the eyes of the people who are working with it. And these are resident issues that we go through the sorts of. Now, very quickly, I'm going to show you some images from my nuclear work. In Japan, most of you would be aware, 2011 was a big tsunami, an earthquake and tsunami, and that meant that there was a radiation disaster in Fukushima, and there were also these power plant buildings which became twisted rubble and are highly radioactive. And there's also this zone of hundreds of square miles of soil and trees or sometimes roads and schools and so on that have been contaminated with radiation, radioactive debris. And what the Japanese government decided is that the state and the elite circles in Japan are very pro-nuclear, and they do not want to take to have any sort of drawback, any sort of impediment to the re-adoption of nuclear energy in Japan, broadly speaking. A lot of the reactors have been closed down after the Fukushima disaster. So here, this is the home monster of Fukushima. They're actually going into the middle of woodlands and sometimes cutting down branches or picking up twigs and rocks and dirt and so on. They're effectively taking this area that is hundreds of square miles and taking about that much of the soil and just taking it away, putting it back. And what happens when you try to clean hundreds of square miles like that is then you have millions of tons of nuclear waste. And so this bag, this big black bag here, is called a footagon. And it weighs about a ton when it's full, and there are millions of these bags all over. This one's dosimeter to check for radiation. And you can tell from the outfits that they take their decontamination seriously and are trying as much as possible to keep radiation at a distance. But you can see how difficult it would be to decontaminate an overgrown forest land like this. And this is actually a pretty small collection of some of these bags. Many thousands of tons
displays. This is a picture from Ipate, which is a bit north of the original exclusion zone. And so they're taking all this waste that's been scraped and putting it in bags. They eventually cover those bags with tarps to keep the rain out and keep the sun out, trying to keep the bags as long as they can. The bags tend to, the manufacturer says that the bags deteriorate after 3 years. So what does that mean? They're trying to keep the waste and let the radiation kind of, it's called natural decay. They're trying to let the radiation decay over about 30 years. But they have to replace these bags every 3 years, let's say. And they also have to move them around. So these were in certain parts of Fukushima, then they moved to other parts of Fukushima. And then they're setting up an inert storage facility, and then we move there. So we're talking about millions of truck trips. So I still don't see the logistical feasibility of moving around that much nuclear waste and managing to also restore these communities for habitation. How many of you want to move back to your former home that you've been evacuated from because of radiation? If they just scrape away some dirt and put down some clean dirt and wipe down your house. I mean, what they're doing is wiping down every single building with wipes and all the ceiling tiles and bringing down all the rooftops. And they're meat whacking and taking down all that stuff and putting it all in bags and sometimes burning it and sometimes storing it like this. And hoping that the communities will come back and that this land will not be like Chernobyl, where it's off limits. So you can see this is an early form of this waste question. So very briefly, Japan is a place that has been metering radiation for quite some time. Godzilla is actually, many Americans would be surprised that it's actually a deeply anti-nuclear film. It was heavily censored when it was shown in the States in the 50s. So we're talking about the height of the Cold War in many ways and the competition with the Soviet Union. So it was a lot was cut out, and there's a lot of critique of radiation and of nuclear policy, nuclear weapons, and so on. So the director was trying to make radiation visible by embodying it in the form of this terrifying monster, which is But this idea of radiation or of these sorts of threats is quite widespread in Japanese pop culture. And I'm sure some of you have come into contact with this. We've got representations of dystopia, dead nations, epidemics, and invisible threats, different sorts of mutation and distortion and existential risks that are set in Japan. And I'm going to stop now. I was going to go on into Japan's plutonium stockpile, and so I'll just show you a few images here. That the idea of nuclear waste as a thermodynamic elixir, kind of a way of having everlasting energy, is something which still endures in Japan. And hell is sort of like a hot spring. Bubbling up and so on, trying to evoke this sense of not only what's happening in Fukushima with the radioactive pools of spent fuel rods and so on bubbling up and trying to be cooled, but also what it would be like to have waste facilities and subterranean repositories all around Japan, which is unfortunately the prospect that Japan is faced with. But they don't have a permanent repository or even an interim repository or some of the waste that we see here. So I'll quickly go through just to end on this. So I would appreciate the sort of stuff that I didn't have time to get into today. I'd be happy to have that come out in questions. But essentially, I'm an anthropologist, and I tend to think that our views of waste are very much colored by the sort of backgrounds that we have because we live languages we speak, and that it's very difficult to look at waste without coming straight up against all these elements that are messy. And anthropology and looking at environmental issues cross-culturally, it's a messy field. There are no easy answers, but I'm convinced that the more you know about a culture, the better chance you have of understanding the waste state there and sorts of challenges. Thank you.
Spider-Man. Is he also radiated and any cultural difference?
differences in these sort of...
There's a lot of accidents. Yeah, so the kind of whole case sort of, again, it seems to be having that happen. And radiation back in the 50s and 60s was a convenient way of drawing comic storylines forward or that kind of thing. So your question is about to what extent radiation is used in that kind of work.
Is everybody freaked out about it? Or are there some cultural differences of some things coming out of Asia, specifically China or Japan, that maybe
right.
color that particular sense of the risk?
Well, back in the 50s and 60s, there was a broad sense that radiation could be controlled. That it was just a matter of, if something got radiated, you just scrub it down and it was fine. There were notorious nuclear tests, American nuclear tests in Bikini Atoll, right? And so there's this huge detonation. What they were doing was detonating nuclear weapons either in the air or underwater and looking at the effect it had on ships. And some of those ships, one of those ships was a notorious Japanese ship. Some of those were German ships, and some of those were American ships that had already been decommissioned. So they were trying to see how much damage they would do. And what they would do, they used to call it got your sweet and got your sour. So once it got your sour, then you just scrub it down until it got your sweet. And it's tough in terminology that they're not looking at radiation in the same way that we might look at radiation these days in America. And so back then, there was a quite different attitude. Protected. I mean, when I was talking about Godzilla being censored as a film when it came to the States, I mean, that was a big deal. That they didn't want people to be concerned about radiation. They wanted people to be thinking about the awesome destructive power of nuclear weapons and how they should protect the populations. So it's interesting to look at, I think it was 1946, in France. There was a new bathing suit, a two-piece bathing suit, very skimpy. And the designer decided he wanted something arresting, so he named it the bikini. And I guarantee, it was a sensation for all sorts of reasons, but the name sort of fit and seemed to give a sense of sultry Southeast Asian climate, sort of South Pacific, and all its allures and all that. But I think we can say that it would never have happened in Japan in 1946 that the Japanese would name the bathing suit the bikini. They have a completely different way of looking at radiation. For a long time, it's been much more sensitive. And one of the great successes of the pro-nuclear lobby in Japan was separating the idea of radiation from nuclear power. So they managed to did lots of propaganda, school visits and so on, they managed to think that there was a separation between nuclear energy and nuclear weapons, and that radiation was a problem with nuclear weapons, like with the bombing of Hiroshima and Nagasaki and nuclear testing and so on, but that radiation was completely under control with nuclear power. And so what I was trying to get at with some of these images of the sort of sublimated nuclear anxieties and come out through the sorts of anime or sorts of manga that they have, or other sorts of popular culture and discourse generally, is that for a long time Japan has been concerned about radiation, but they have always associated that with nuclear energy and nuclear devastation and stuff like that. NGOs, and these are not just from one town, they tend to be
nevertheless smaller scale than something like Friends of Blue, their office in the Jays. There's a lot of difficulty that a lot of pressure they get from the states and from other groups. So sometimes they'll fall under the auspices of the university as sort of institutional protection, and other times they might have to change the name and so on. It's you know, as you can probably tell from the news, looking at what happens in China generally, it's not an easy place to be an environmental activist. There are lawyers, for example, environmental lawyers who, you know, very bravely go up against the factories, the lead mines, and all these places which are, there's this phenomenon of cancer villages, and that's primarily what my colleague Anna is focused on, is cancer villages in places which have a lot of toxic pollution, a lot of environmental devastation. But what often happens is that, like the blue industry, there are a lot of people benefiting from that trade. And it would be difficult in the community of the lead mine to have a vocal opposition group who's saying that lead is bad for us, or that this company is not very well, because, you know, a lot of those people are working with them, and a lot of those people are related to people. So, you know, it's easy to expect. But it's something which I would say 15 years ago, the NGO presence in China was much lower than it is now, or has been over the past decade or so. And it's just a difficult terrain.
Thank you. Yes, Colin.
Any other questions?
I'm from California, and I was living there when Fukushima happened. And so, I just watched it. I was sort of obsessed and watched it for days and days. And actually, the town I was living in had road base was destroyed by the tidal wave on the other side. So it was a big deal to me. And I know that France went through a lot of tourism, really safe nuclear plants right after Fukushima. And I was wondering, what is, if you know, what are the comparisons? Obviously, Japan doesn't have a really great nuclear waste disposal process. Do other countries, if you know, do other countries have any sort of, I mean, is there any real way to dispose of nuclear waste, is what I'm asking. Right. I mean, obviously, this idea of putting bags in, you know, in waste piles, you know, is part of a way of reassuring people it's safe, but it's not necessarily safe, right? So I'm wondering if all of these processes of these countries trying to reassure their citizens that it's okay, nuclear is okay, is, from what you've seen, is it okay, is it ever okay? Is there any real way to deal with this?
So I'm convinced that the very expensive and error-prone effort to draw energy from nuclear waste is not very quick. And there's this facility called Wonju, which I believe you should show you. You might have seen this subliminal image you can flip through. Wonju was completed in 1994, I believe, and tumbled offline in 1995. Since then, they've been trying to get it going. It hasn't been produced for any commercial energy, no more than a trickle over about 20 years or longer. And so we've got this place which is very expensive, costs about $12 million, and there's this whole reprocessing facility in Wokasho, which is trying to take the spent nuclear fuel rods and things like that and other sorts of waste, and they're trying to extract usable uranium, and they're also trying to extract plutonium. And you can use plutonium in theory, this is why everybody wants to try to make it work. In theory, you could have this sort of a virtuous cycle where you were always getting more plutonium from the reprocessing. But reprocessing creates waste. It creates a lot of waste. And so you're taking one form of waste and turning it into other forms of waste. And the other thing is that it's never commercially been
made to work properly. So the, this this idea of having a fast feeder reactor and being able to have energy produced for thousands of years, which is the limit that the nuclear industry can, it's really not going to happen. And they're still clinging to that idea, and that's what's so frustrating to look at. So I would argue that you need to vary. I mean, a lot of people say that the safest way to deal with something like plutonium is to vary. This is weapons usable plutonium. It can be used in warheads. It could be, it may not be, you know, just put it on top, but it's dangerous stuff. And so it needs to be buried in a secure facility, and it may be there for 100,000 years. So we're talking about a really serious expenditure, which is not often included in the calculations of whether people manage it as effective and cheap and so on. So there are some places around the world that are trying to come up with waste storage. One of them is Finland, where they're blasting, using dynamite to blast away chambers in granite in a place called Honkola. And they're almost done. So that's interesting. They have this big complex, and they've tried to figure out if they could have it there for about 100,000 years, and they're trying to hide it so that nobody messes around with it. I mean, you think about 10,000 years from now, are people going to be speaking English? Is there going to be democracy, or is there going to be a monarchy of some sort of kind, or is there going to be, going to legit revert to tribal sorts of competition? What sort of world are we going to have 10,000 years, 100,000 years? Nobody has any clue what's going to happen in 100,000 years. So we need a secure facility that can be there and be out of harm's way for a long time. And interestingly, America has, where Obama started to use subterranean salt formations. And what they're doing is scraping away chambers there. It's called WIPP or WIP, and it's located near Carlsbad in New Mexico. And so we've got these places that, in theory, would be able to store either one of their waste, and the radiation would go into the water table, and it'd be relatively secure from earthquakes. That's the sort of thing we're worried about when you have subterranean waste formations, and you're trying to protect the waste. But it's not easy to do, and it's expensive. And one thing I've controversially argued is that Japan is very seismic. And you know, we've just seen that in the last 5 years. Right? So it's not really possible to have a subterranean facility there for 100,000 years. I mean, it's a crazy idea. There's a very pro-nuclear outfit called the Agency for Natural Resources and Environment, ANRE. And they proposed just recently, just a few months ago, they were proposing to dig a subterranean tunnel out about 12 kilometers off the coast of Japan, so it wouldn't contravene international law. And they would have a repository under the ocean out there. And I'm thinking, you know, oh, it'd be really convenient if an earthquake would just be inaccessible. I don't know, it's hard for me to know what they're thinking of, but the idea is preposterous. Just five years after Fukushima. So we've got different sorts of ideologies who are either pro-nuclear and anti-nuclear. France is a very pro-nuclear country if you talk about the elite, and a lot of people in France are more or less pro-nuclear even today. And there are people with a science background usually who are convinced that radiation is going to be healed and that it's a good way to avoid climate change and greenhouse gases. So this is an ongoing debate, and I don't see any urgency in trying to have subterranean facilities or secure facilities. But it will probably be.
We'll wrap up, I think, after one or two more questions.
So I noticed in a lot of the coverage of the Fukushima disaster, especially in the U.S., there's often a lot of talk about bureaucratic failures on the part of the Japanese government. And it was interesting to see in the new Godzilla movie that the accident in Fukushima, if I'm remembering correctly, wasn't a nuclear accident. It was essentially a bureaucratic failure because they brought in the big monster to Fukushima, which then destroyed the plant. And so I was wondering if you see in more recent cultural things from Japan, not recent Godzilla movie was American made, but in things from Japan that essentially point the blame or subliminally or you know sort of follow up with this idea of a bureaucratic failure in front of the Japanese rather than a nuclear anxiety.
Yeah, very revealingly there was a report that came out in sort of a, it's not the same as in the States, but let's imagine it's a New Urban commission that was it was all put in motion by the Prime Minister's office, and they were trying to figure out what went wrong with Fukushima. And in the American, sorry, in the English language version, it says this is a cultural problem. This is something that was made in Japan, and this is something we really need to confront. That doesn't appear in the Japanese version. So it's clear that people are aware, and I'm not just talking about people in important commissions and members of the establishment, but that everyday Japanese in communities inside and outside can see that the way that the nuclear industry has been operating has been problematic, and that there were safeguards which were working properly, there were cozy ties between the regulators and the people in the industry. But nevertheless, it's difficult to keep that idea in the forefront of your mind when now Japan is the world's largest importer of liquid natural gas because they have a large proportion of their electricity that was originally being generated from nuclear power, and then that disappeared and set everything offline. There's just one reactor which is still operating in one plant. So there are very compelling economic reasons for Japan to get it going. The current government is very much putting to reinvigorate the economy. And so this sense of bureaucratic failures is well acknowledged, but it's still difficult to make a meaningful transformation. And I think this is getting on for some time. There's a sense that, well, we've done our best and we've corrected this. We've got a new set of procedures here and very stringent tests, which are the strictest in the world. And so I think it's going to be well. But that idea is certainly.
Anybody desires to ask one last question? Okay, let's thank Peter one more time. Thank you very much.
Thank you.